campaign. Now, joining us in this conversation is Ariel Kahana, the diplomatic correspondent for the Yisrael Hayom media outlet, which is co-sponsoring this series. Here's Bogi Yaalon on the elections, Iran, President Biden's Mideast policies, and much more. Moshe Bogi Yaalon, thank you for joining us on I-24 News. I'd like to start with a political question. It's really the only one I have. Your party, Telem, running independently, so far is polling below the threshold. That may change, but it's surely its chances would be better if you were to join with another party. Is that something you would consider doing? And is there a party there that you feel ideologically comfortable with joining, maybe even more than your previous partner, Yesh Atid?
Thank you for having me, first of all, Claire and Shalom. I joined politics in order to fix the situation in Israel. And no doubt that we are now engaged in the most significant crisis since the Independence War, 1948. 4,300 casualties. The pandemic is going on and going on. And political consideration has been affected. The ability to meet the challenge of the COVID-19, whether it is opening the Ben-Gurion airport, although we are an island country, we have to compare ourselves to New Zealand as an example, with 25 casualties, and nowadays they found a single case of a pandemic, which someone was infected probably in the last 2 months, and we have now 7,000 Israelis who have been infected because of political consideration. That's why I'm in politics. And I'm here today, before the fourth round of elections, ready to do everything in order to replace this very bad government. I will do my utmost in order to replace it, whether it be by myself, Telem Party. I call to join forces, because I understand the political situation today, with those who are ready to go this way. It is not right or left today. It's about being corrupt or honest. It's about democracy or dictatorship. It's about telling the truth or using fake news or what lies or whatever. That's why I'm here. I'll do my utmost to replace the government.
So would you join, or is it a possibility to join Gideon Saar, who also broke out of the Likud like you?
I don't want to discuss the options. But you know, it's quite amazing. The collapse of the Blue and White Party, which I was part of it, which was created in order to replace the government, at the end of the days, Benny Gantz, Gabi Ashkenazi, joined his government, allow it to go on with his
own. So you see Gideon Saar will join Netanyahu in the end?
I hope that not, but I'm not sure. He spent quite a while with Prime Minister Netanyahu, although he knew about the corruption, he knew the details, he knew that something bad was happening with the Likud party, which I was part of. And he was silent until recently, with Elkin, with others. Not talking about Naftali Bennett.
So Saar is not an option, okay.
No, and Naftali Bennett as well. He was ready to immune Prime Minister Netanyahu with all his allegations, which had become indictments. So I can't trust them.
Okay. Right. Let's move to some of the issues that whoever's in the next government is going to have to deal with, even beyond the coronavirus. You were the Minister of Defense when the Iran nuclear agreement was signed. You said it was a catastrophe, not just for Israel, but for the Western world. We now have a government in the United States that wants to return to that agreement. What is your response to the Biden administration? What would you say to them? You want to go back, but what has to be done? What has to be changed in order to make it viable?
No doubt that the JCPOA, the agreement with Iran, was a historic mistake. Nevertheless, President Trump as well, which did quite a lot in order to push and to press the Iranian regime, decided to abandon the agreement. In this case, in the very beginning, I said it might be a mistake because the Iranians were going to exploit it. And Trump's intention was to the sanctions, the economic sanctions, the political isolation, in order to bring back the Iranians to the table. He hadn't reached it. Nevertheless, I'm afraid that if President Biden, the new administration, we go back to the Obama administration policy, it will be another mistake. I hope that Israelis today from the defense establishment are engaged already with Biden administration's defense establishment experts to deal what should be done, whether they are going to sit to the table or not, because it is quite crucial to put it very clear, by one way or another, the Iranian regime, this fanatic regime, shouldn't have a military nuclear option. And I hope that the administration, not just on the Iranian issue, will understand that the situation in the Middle East has been changed for favor of Israel and our neighboring countries, the Arabs, and not to go back to the old, very bad policy of President Obama administration.
So I want to follow up about that, because there are now two attitudes inside the Biden administration. One is saying we should first go back to the JCPOA, and then afterwards try to fix it with negotiations with the Iranians. The other one said, no, first of all, we have to get the agreement by the Iranians to change the JCPOA, and just afterwards to lift up the sanctions. What's your position about those two options?
It should be, as it should have been, a combination. Economic pressure, as long as the Iranian regime doesn't obey the whole idea of giving up the military nuclear option, political isolation, mobilizing the P5+1 and more parties to join forces with the United States. It wasn't the case with Trump, it was his decision to do it alone, to have a credible military option in order to convince the regime that they are very serious before sitting to the table. And then sitting to the table, discussing not just the enrichment. It's about what is called the military dimension of the project, the missiles, and even the proliferation of terrors and arms in the Middle East. All those issues should have been discussed with the Iranians under pressure.
Let's talk about another issue that has returned to Washington that we haven't heard in the last 4 years. You personally have spoken out against a two-state solution with the Palestinians, even though you were willing to make a political partnership with other leaders who did support it. But now there's an administration that very much sees that as the viable solution to the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. How should the Israeli government or Israeli leaders in or out of government respond when the Biden administration comes and says it's time to put the two-state solution firmly back on the table?
I hope that the Biden administration will learn from the Trump administration experience, which has become more realistic than earlier administration. I claim that the Israeli-Palestinian conflict is not the core of instability in the Middle East. I don't have to prove it. The conflict in Iraq, in Syria, in Libya, in Lebanon, in Yemen, is not because of us. It's not because of the Palestinian issue. And what has been achieved by the Trump administration is to have this kind of relationship with the Sunni Arab regimes. Let's leave alone the Palestinian issue. So nowadays, it should have been realized by the Biden administration.
I mean, realistically, do you expect the Biden administration to accept that as an answer?
Yes.
You're looking at some of the people that are already involved in the administration.
I hope so. You have to learn from the recent history in which there is no Israeli-Arab conflict. For meanwhile, the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. But this is not the core for instability in the Middle East. Let's leave it alone. Let's leave it alone. I don't see a final settlement with the Palestinians whatsoever, neither with Abu Mazen and others, not talking before about Arafat. I don't know who will be the successor, but we have to learn from the history. They are not ready to share the land of Israel with us. So I can't see the end of conflict, finality of claims.
I want to make a specific question about this issue. The new administration is considering to open a consulate in East Jerusalem. What's your opinion about a consulate, maybe kind of embassy, American embassy in East Jerusalem?
It's going to be a tremendous mistake because the Palestinians have to learn the lessons of history. You are not partners for even territorial compromise. You refused Barak proposal in Camp David. You rejected President Clinton proposal of December 2000. You rejected Olmert proposal after Annapolis. What you are looking for? To use the Oslo Agreement and what have been achieved as a phase in the phases theory, we are not going to cooperate with it, neither us, and hopefully we will convince the Biden administration not to cooperate with it.
I have to ask you, the positions you've articulated on Iran, on the Palestinians, are not so different from those of Benjamin Netanyahu. If these are really such pressing issues, and the only option for a viable government that will respond to the U.S. is one that is headed by Benjamin Netanyahu, but couldn't, is that not a government you're willing to join, at least and on a temporary basis?
Khaleb, I was the defense minister of Benjamin Netanyahu's government. And I can see today and applaud him for him on strategic issues, foreign affairs issues. I can't tolerate what he's doing now internally, whether it is about the division among the tribes in Israel, in the society, Jews, Arabs, Ashkenazi, non-Ashkenazi, right, left. It is an existential threat for the country to have such an environment and atmosphere in our society. Then about all those cases in which he's indicted already and will be indicted in the future.
It's now 5 years that you personally is having this crusade against Netanyahu. And actually, in all those elections, now it's going to be 4 elections, even once you didn't cross the minimum limit. In other words, you do not convince the public with those claims.
You are very right, Ariel. And you can look at the affairs, the probes, 1,000, 2,000, 4,000, the way that he controls so many elements in the media and the agenda. And people, you know...
Come on, but you're moving from one studio to another. You cannot you cannot claim that you and your colleagues do not have an opportunity to convince the public. Okay? The people heard you, he heard him, and you know, the numbers are talking for themselves.
I don't have my own media assets.
He doesn't have it as well.
Okay, let's talk about it after the discussion here. And you know, I don't control the agenda. You know, he failed even on the coronavirus. He has to be resigned because of his failure.
It's not so
as
sure.
As the prime minister.
Comparing to other states, it's not so sure.
So, you know, you can cheat too many people too long time. That's my understanding from our situation today, which is a pity. It's a tragedy.
I think we'll have to leave it there. Ariel Khan of Yisrael Hayom, Moshe Bogi Alon.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us.
Thank you. 24 News.